I can do this, and I will do this. This is what I tell myself each day. Times are tough these days. All you have to do is turn on the news to find out.
Issue that will trigger the next financial meltdown.
I'm not here to talk about plans to deal with this till 2017. I'm saying we've got a real problem.
Debt is crushing us, with the average American household owing $15,000 on their credit card, $33,000 in student loans, the number of people who work their whole lives and still retire with debt is skyrocketing. People don't even think it's possible to be upwardly mobile anymore. That's the American dream. They think it's dead. You probably know someone that feels the same way. But my friend, they are wrong. History shows us that people have always faced adversity and have overcome obstacles. So can you. And for me, I know your choice matters. Because of racial segregation, I wasn't even allowed to use the front door of the bank in Greenville, Mississippi. I remember the back door, but I refused to let that slight cause me to fail. Without the idea of family setting and making a living in the cotton fields of the Delta, I shifted my thinking, and so can you. I imagined possibilities that did not even exist at the moment, but they eventually became my reality. I became a Pulitzer-nominated author, an entrepreneur, who helped to introduce Stairmaster exercise system to the world. Now the president and CEO of two small businesses and one of the owners of a bank that 50 years ago, I wouldn't have been able to even walk through the front door. The American dream is not dead. Let me say it again. The American dream is not dead. Maybe a jumpstart is all it needs. So was my success a choice? You better believe it was definitely my choice. You see, adversity for many of us is a catalyst that initiates the change. It isn't easy. It's not always fun, but it's a choice. You can do this. No matter what situation you find yourself in, you can maximize your potential. You will meet adversity. Trust me, it will strengthen you. You will fail. It will be lessons learned you will never forget. You will be challenged, but your creativity will amaze you. Get-rich-quick schemes don't work, no matter how enticing. But if you're willing to shift your thinking and make the choice to work hard, believe in yourself, and continually educate yourself, you can accomplish whatever it is that you have imagined. Just imagine the possibilities and be ready to work them into reality. You know, we're excited to help you jumpstart your own success story. Now roll up your sleeves. You can do this. Be your own dream come true. Welcome to Thrive.
Some shows don't need a celebrity narrator to introduce the show, but this show does. In a world filled with endless opportunities, why would two men who have built 13 multi-million dollar businesses altruistically invest 5 hours per day to teach you the best practice business systems and moves that you can use? Because they believe in you, and they have a lot of time on their hands. They started from the bottom, now they're here. It's the Thrivetime Show, starring the former U.S. Small Business Administration's Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark, and the entrepreneur trapped inside an optometrist's body, Dr. Robert Zollner. Two men. 8 kids, co-created by 2 different women. 13 multi-million dollar businesses.
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here.
We started from the bottom, and now we're at the top, teaching you the systems to get what we got. Colton Dixon's on the hooks, I break down the books. The seeds bringing some wisdom and the good looks. As the father of 5, that's why I'm alive. So if you see my wife and kids, please tell them hi. It's the CNC up on your radio. And now 3, 2, 1, here we go.
We started from the bottom, now we're here. From the bottom.
Today's guest is Jason Khalipa. He's a committed husband, father, and author, and the 2008 CrossFit Games champion. Thus, he was known as the fittest man on earth. He is the founder of the NC Fit Gyms, with 6 locations around the world, with 5 locations in California and 1 in Mexico. And now he's the best-selling author of As Many Reps as Possible, succeeding in competition, business, and life by making the most out of every single moment. Throughout Jason's life, he's chosen to stay positive as he's fought through endless adversity, including the moment when his daughter, Ava, was diagnosed with leukemia. And he believes the only real life hack is to work really hard.
Some shows don't need a celebrity narrator to introduce the show. But this show does. 2 men, 8 kids, co-created by 2 different women, 13 multi-million dollar businesses. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Thrivetime Show.
Now 3, 2, 1, here we go!
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. We started from the bottom, now we're 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 here.
Jason, welcome on to the Thrivetime Show. How are you, sir?
I'm doing very well. Thank you so much for having me.
Hey, I'm a little bit overwhelmed and a lot honored to have you on today's show, because your career is sort of legendary and iconic at this point. I have to ask you this. When you finished first in the 2008 CrossFit Games, did you blow your own mind?
Well, I mean, at the time, I didn't really know what it'd turn into. And so, I mean, yeah, I did blow my own mind, actually. Yeah, that's a good way to describe it. Yes, I did.
So I'd love for you to break down. I mean, you wrote this book called As Many Reps as Possible, which is kind of a look into your mind, a look into your mindset, a look into your values. And I want to really focus in on this book. And in chapter 1 of your book, you write, A Set of Tools to Set You Free. What is the first chapter of this book all about?
Well, I mean, the first chapter, so there's a kind of chapter before the first chapter, which would have typically been a preface.
Yep.
But in our case, we labeled it as, you know, how it all began. And what that was just a story of when my daughter diagnosed with leukemia, how this tool set that I incorporated in my life for so long allowed us to overcome that challenge. And then the first chapter is a tool set that allows you to kind of reach your full potential, which is the AMRAP mentality, which is about identifying your why, knowing what you want to focus on, focusing on what's in your control, working really hard at that particular focus, switch gears throughout your day, and then reevaluate when life kind of throws you a curveball is the tool set that we use.
Now, was it an actual system that you'd written down and broken down on paper, the AMRAP philosophy and principle, or is that something that you worked on over time? I want to kind of know, because my son was born blind in 2007, which is why I relate, I believe, so much to your story, you know. And nothing's worse than having your child going through something and feeling helpless as a parent. Did you already have your philosophy distilled at that point, or how did you come about this philosophy?
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously, I don't know, you know, with your son being blind, I'm sure that came with a ton of, you know, in the beginning, I'm sure it really shook you, and it was, you know, you had to learn how to adapt and overcome. And now I'm sure there's been a lot of potential positives that have occurred through this adversity and having to overcome it. And the same thing kind of happened with us, where at first it was a huge shock. But now as we've kind of transitioned through, we've realized a lot of good has came out of it, with relationships, with different types of things. But, you know, at first when we were developing this mindset, it was more like, how am I going to compete at the CrossFit Games and win? How am I going to build a big business? And then how am I going to be a good husband and father? And so when I was debating that in my head, that's when I started creating this tool set, because I never was more productive in my workouts than when I was AMRAPing them. Once I started introducing a clock to my workouts, my results exponentially increased. That same thing I wanted to impact the rest of my life.
And again, AMRAP, for anybody out there taking notes, stands for As Many Reps as Possible. Am I getting that correct?
That's right. Yeah, it's an acronym for, you know, as many reps as possible. So the way to think about it is, you know, you have 10 minutes if I just said, hey, you know, do me a favor and just do 10 push-ups, 10 sit-ups, 10 squats, you know, casually, you might be able to get an okay workout. But if I said, hey, do 10 push-ups, 10 squats, et cetera, and I want you to do as many reps as possible in 10 minutes, go, you'd get a lot more of a, you'd get a much better stimulus from that.
I want to get into your head before winning the 2008 CrossFit Games. When did you decide to take this seriously and to say, you know what, I might have a shot at winning this, or this is something I want to do? Was that 2006, 2007? I mean, when did that light bulb?
I mean, I was in love with training and competing, and you know, that was a good thing for me. But after that year, winning was really when I started to focus on it. It actually, I was surprised I won. And the competition was a lot different in 2008 than it was, you know, when I finished up in 2015. And, you know, it wasn't something I set out to win. I set out to just kind of see where I stacked up against my competitors. And winning was just this huge kind of byproduct of that.
So when you're competing in the CrossFit Games, because you retired from the CrossFit Games or competing in 2015, am I correct on that?
Yeah, so I competed 7 times the individual and then once as a team in 2015.
So when you were competing, and let's say, what's the most difficult contest, the most difficult exercise, the most difficult part of the CrossFit Games in your mind? Is there a particular aspect of it you say that part is the worst?
Well, it's anything you're not prepared for, right? That's the worst. So, you know, going into these CrossFit Games, you never know what you're going to get yourself into at all. And so the secret is, how prepared can you be? And if you go in there and you're not prepared for a long event or a swim event or whatever that may be, that's when they're the worst events, is when you're not going in there with the confidence from all your training to go out there and know that you're going to perform well.
Can you, let us kind of into your brain. Here we go. We're going into your brain. Let's picture 2008, maybe 2009, and you're going in and you're going, okay, this was, what was the event where you were competing and you thought, oh, wow, this is harder than I thought it would be?
Well, I mean, fast forward to like 2011,
yeah.
We had a Camp Pendleton military base. We had a triathlon, and that was much harder than I anticipated because I wasn't prepared. I wasn't ready for a long swim, bike, and run. And because of that, it was detrimental. I mean, it broke me. And after that year, I told myself I would never let that happen again.
What do you say to yourself when you're going through something mentally? You know, what's the self-talk look like with this AMRAP philosophy in your mind when you're going through a grueling, you know, maybe you're doing pull-ups or you're doing some activity and you're going, I just am out of gas. What do you say to yourself? Just let us into the self-talk. What are you saying to yourself?
Well, man, I'm trying to utilize positive self-talk. And so what I'm thinking about is if I have, you know, an athlete at our gym and I'm coaching them, what kind of things am I going to tell them? Well, I'm surely not going to tell them that they can't breathe. I'm not going to tell them that your legs hurt. I'm going to tell them, hey, focus on your technique. Focus on driving your knees out, keeping your chest up. Focus on, you know, identifying a nice breathing pattern. And so then I take that same mindset and I shift it into myself. So I'm utilizing positive self-talk, which exercise is a great way to develop this. So in the middle of competitions, I'm focusing on what I can control, which is my own performance. I'm positively reinforcing that throughout the workout. And then before I get into the event, I create a game plan, whatever that game plan is. And I work really hard to stick with that game plan and rely on my training. Because what happens is a lot of times, you get in the middle of one of these events and your competitors might go off, you know, and go out super fast and you want to kind of keep up with them, but you need to remind yourself that you created a game plan for a specific reason when your heart rate was, you know, whatever. And the goal is to now, you know, stick with the game plan, and with a few minutes left in the event, boom, you know, game plan goes out the window and just go out there and crush it.
Can you let us, I mean, maybe this is a weird request, but could you tell me, I mean, do you speak this audibly? Do you actually say the words audibly to yourself while you're going through these adversities?
I mean, I think in the garage, you could kind of develop this skill. I think anybody who's looking to, you know, kind of, you know, support their performance outside the gym should use the gym as a great way of doing that. So now, if I'm in the middle of a workout and I'm challenging, internally I'm saying certain things to myself. And in the beginning, it's really tough. You know, imagine if you go out for a run, the first thing you're saying to yourself is, oh man, my feet hurt, my lungs hurt, my whatever hurt. But if you could transfer that negativity into a positive, that's a strong, strong thing. Now the question becomes, how do you translate that in your daily life? when you're in a meeting and something doesn't go the right way, that these are sets of skills that you could develop through exercise that transfer really well into real life. And normally, I'm not saying I'm outside, like I'm not saying them out loud. I'm saying them internally.
Okay, so you're saying them internally. Now, in your book, As Many Reps as Possible, in chapter 2, you decided to thoughtfully title this chapter, Unlock Your Why and Build a Personal Powerhouse. I would love for you to break down what this means and why it's so important.
Well, I mean, I think anytime you're going up for a challenge, whatever that may be, you need to know why you're doing it and have a strong set of, you know, values that support it. When you're trying to compete at the CrossFit Games, the amount of pain that your body goes through is extreme. And if you don't have a strong internal reason why you're doing it, you're never going to be successful. And that same thing applies to anything else you're doing. You know, why are you going to school? Why are you working? What's the bigger reason? Because when adversity strikes and when challenges occur, you need to have a strong why for everything you're doing. And if you can relate to that, if you can fall back on that, you'll always be successful.
You, again, from what I can just read online and what I've heard about you, is that you are very passionate about your wife, Ashley, I believe her name is, Ashley, and your two kids. And a lot of people, unfortunately, in America today, maybe struggle with keeping the marriage together. I've been married 18 years. How long have you been married?
We've been married coming up on 10 years, but we've been dating for, we started dating when we were 15. So I'm 33 now. So whatever that is, 18 years.
Okay. I got 5 years of age on you there. So I'm 38 here. So a little bit older than you, but you've been married 10 years, been dating your high school sweetheart. What you're doing as far as your love for your wife, you always speak very favorably about her on every interview you've ever done. Whenever you're talking about your wife, it's not a negative, passive aggressive. It's a very powerfully purposeful, powerful, passionate, you know, you love her, and it's very evident in what you say about her. What is the why that makes your marriage so successful when so many other people, you know, seem to struggle with making their marriage work?
Well, I think you have to find the right person that's going to kind of, you know, create something inside you that you want to be the best version of yourself for them, right? And so for us, you know, I feel like I got really lucky at a young age finding somebody that, you know, made me be about something, you know, made me kind of be a man about it. And, has been there supporting me, and I've been supporting her, and we've been trying to lift each other up since we were 15. So I think my why was that I found someone excellent who made me better, and I want to keep her.
There we go. Okay, this is somebody who makes you want to be excellent, and you want to keep her. This is maybe something you and I share here. My wife is, you know, people always say, your wife looks just like Joanna Gaines. And I go, thank you. They go, you look just like Jabba the Hutt, or you know what I mean? You look just like Yoda. I mean, it seems like we married up, and your wife is a big encourager there. Can you talk to me about the role that she plays? Is it time to find an accountant who's as proactive about your finances as you are? Is it time for a CPA to take a second look under your financial hood? Is it time to find a CPA who cares about making sure that you are headed in the right direction financially? Well, if that's the case, then check out our good friends at HoodCPAs.com. That's HoodCPAs.com. And for a limited time, when you schedule your free one-hour consultation with a member of the Hood CPA team, you will receive one free copy of Warren Buffett's only authorized biography, the book Snowball, Warren Buffett and the Business of Life. Claim your free book and schedule your one-hour free consultation today simply by going to HoodCPAs.com. Once again, that's HoodCPAs.com. Stay tuned.
Attend the world's best business workshop led by America's number one business coach for free by subscribing on iTunes and leaving us an objective review. Claim your tickets by emailing us proof that you did it and your contact information to info@thrivetimeshow.com.
Yes, 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 and yes. Welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on your radio and podcast download. Andrew, on today's show, we are interviewing the fittest man in the world.
Mm.
And even though it could be false advertising, it's not you. It's wow. you although you are the fittest man in the world.
Unfortunately.
And it's not me. It is Jason Khalipa. In 2008, Jason Khalipa won the CrossFit Games and thus became the fittest man in the world. He was then able to leverage his tenacity, his expertise, his celebrity to open up six gyms. He has five gym locations in California. Wow. And one location here in, or one location in Mexico. So one in Mexico, south of the border, one in California, which is left of Oklahoma.
That's
and
true.
On today's show, we have the tag team duo of Colton and Rusty. These guys have a tumbling gym located in Tulsa that teaches kids how to tumble, fantastic gymnastics, that whole thing. So Colton, how are you? And welcome onto the show, my friend.
Doing fine. How are you, sir?
Well, I'm excited to have you on the show here. My wife is a big fan of your business. We have five kids, four of which are girls, three of which that tumble. And we've decided to spend all of our discretionary income on tumbling classes. And so we really do love what you guys do. And my wife is obsessed with cheer and tumbling. So I'd like for you to introduce your business, Justice Tumbling, and share with the listeners how you first got involved with tumbling.
Well, my name is Colton Cruz, and my partner, Rusty Bratzler, and I, we decided that 3 months ago we were going to start our own company. We've been doing coaching for a long time, and our heart's in it, and we wanted to be able to do our own thing.
I have to ask you, when you hit the start button, the go button, did you talk to Rusty first, and then did you talk to your wife? Did you talk to your wife, then Rusty? Tell us the order. And I realize they're here in the studio, too, so if you need to change your story slightly, I understand. But I just want to know, did you talk to Rusty first, then your wife? What was that order?
Well, Rusty and I got a phone call from Rusty, and he decided that he was going to be leaving our previous owner, or our previous gym, and the phone call went, well, I guess if you're leaving, I'm going to be leaving because we're starting our own gym, and I'll have to talk to my wife about it later.
Was it scary?
No, because... We have this faith.
Surprisingly, we should have been scared, but as soon as we made the decision, everything was easy after that.
Well, I can say this. I don't know you, Colton, as well as I know about Rusty, but my wife always describes Rusty as probably the most diligent, hardworking guy she's ever seen.
Yes,
and every client, and Andrew, you've seen it, every client that we work with that succeeds is pretty much who?
Some of the clients that succeed?
Yeah. Aren't they all the same person? Hardworking, diligent?
The exact same people. They do the same thing. They wake up at the same time. They have the same schedule. It's incredible.
Like Papa Gallo's.
Yep.
The guys who run Papa Gallo's pizza in Florida.
Yep.
Aren't they just really hard workers?
They're great. They always are on top of things. They're doing their action items. They're diligent. They're incredible people.
So the cool thing about our program is we teach people, you know, what to do, but they have to actually do it. I'm sure it's the same thing for you guys with tumbling. I mean, if a kid enrolls in tumbling this week, let's say Rusty, a parent enrolls their kid in tumbling classes today, and the family's very well-to-do. They have all the money in the world. What's the best age for a kid to start tumbling? The best age?
The best age, the prime age, is start them young, get in as quick as you can, about 5-6 years old. I was a late starter, and all the kids I coach nowadays at 11 years old are out tumbling what I was doing at probably 15 years old. So
isn't it possible though for somebody who has all the money in the world for their kid to be absolutely terrible at tumbling if they don't put in the work?
Oh, absolutely. We can spend their spending months telling kids to do the same thing, and it could be a year down the line and a light bulb will finally click and they'll actually try what we've been telling them the same thing for months.
And couldn't you be the poorest of the poor and become awesome if you're willing to put in the work?
Usually the people who pay for privates themselves out of their own pockets, they're not having mom and dad pay for it. Usually those are the kids who are willing to try a lot more.
You mean 15, 16-year-olds paying out of their own pocket for tumbling classes?
Yes. Yeah. Then those are my favorite kids to work with because they don't want to waste any time. They only want to get better. So,
you know, my wife and I, our strategy, people always ask, well, where'd you get the money to start the company? Our strategy was we got a job at Target, Applebee's, DirecTV. That was my three. Target, Applebee's, DirecTV. Why? Because I had no skill and they needed entry-level people. That's why I started. Target, Applebee's, and DirecTV. That was my tip. Vanessa went to Office Depot where she served as kind of the office manager because she had more skill and she was a cheerleading coach at Oral Roberts University. And that's how we funded it. We always tell people, you know, live below the means is kind of the move. When you guys opened up the first gym, was it scary to sign a lease, Colton, to rent space? Did it freak you out at all?
It did. We didn't have another fallback when we left our former employee. That's That's all we had.
So you're sufficiently motivated.
Sufficiently motivated, absolutely.
Right, okay, okay. Now, do you have an early highlight so far, Colton? An early highlight of Justice Tumbling where you go, that was a really cool thing. Maybe the first person that found you online or the first person that was referred by a friend. Do you have like a benchmark, an early win over there for Justice Tumbling?
Absolutely. So as of week one, whenever we started Justice, with our former employer, we were working with five schools,
yeah,
and all five of those schools followed us.
Whoa! So you guys you guys have good momentum.
Absolutely.
I always plan for the worst, hope for the best, and I expected to lose about 90% of my clientele leaving, and we ended up switching. I only lost maybe 5 to 10%, and everybody else followed.
Are you going on the ramen noodle diet? Is that what you guys are up to, Colton? I mean, are you just kind of surviving on only ramen noodles through the
exactly
lean portion of the business here?
I told my wife the other day that we're going to have to turn off our heat.
We did that. My wife and I have done this, yes.
She wasn't too happy about it.
Yeah.
We are taking a lot of the stuff we're learning from you, living below our means. Mm-hmm. We're in the process of trying to sell our house that we wish we never probably would have gotten into.
Yeah.
But so trying to do that and get back on track.
I remember we lived in an apartment at 71st and Lewis, and we had probably five employees. And people were like, dude, why don't you buy a house? And I'm like, because I got to buy more equipment. And then we had like 10 guys. People were going, why do you live in this small apartment without the air conditioning? It's because we got to buy another van. And we just kept doing that. And then people said, man, you have a huge house. When we bought the Lynn Lane house. And I'm like, yeah, because we've been living in a crappy apartment. Get off me. You know what I mean? So it's kind of a delay gratification. Then you can have some fun later.
Our first month, we were thinking, okay, we're going to go a month without getting paid. And then month two came around and we were like, oh, we got to get equipment. And then month three, we said, no, we got to get a gym.
Yeah.
And then now
I will tell you, most people who buy a franchise, and this is not maybe indicative of your industry, but most people who buy a franchise, you know, like a Subway or a Sports Clips or a Little Caesars or an Oxy Fresh, they're usually looking to break even, to stop spending more money than they're bringing in within 12 months. That's the goal. 12 months is sort of like that's the goal. And if it's a big business, they usually shoot for the first 5 years. So my prediction is you guys will probably hit the profit zone probably month 8 or 9, if not faster. But then you never have to go backwards again. And then you start making copious amounts of money. And then you start buying your wife's nice shoes. And then you start buying organic stuff at Whole Foods. You know, they're expensive kale.
Yep, kale.
And then you start to become a meat snob where if it wasn't free range, you won't eat it. And then you start to, you know, buy Tom Ford shoes. And then you become a yuppie.
Wear jerseys all
the time.
That's the steps to success. Now, Thrive Nation, when we return from the break, we're going to be interviewing Jason Khalipa, the winner of the 2008 CrossFit Games. Again, Jason Khalipa. Do a quick Google search during the break. Check this guy out. It's Jason, Khalipa. He's also the best-selling author of the book, As Many Reps as Possible, and the founder of a six-gym business called NC Fit. Stay tuned.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, it's Business School Without the BS, featuring optometrist-turned-entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zellner with USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark. Won't you exercise my mind? Won't you exercise my mind? I want to be free as I'll ever be. Exercise my mind. Help me exercise.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to your show if you want to earn time and financial freedom. And Andrew, I have a deep New Year's thought for you.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Most of the men that I know who are very successful, most of the men that I know who are very successful, they all have a great spouse.
That's true.
And I have discovered that this is how life is done at Camp Clark and Chicken Palace. Let me explain to you how it's done. We'll think about putting in a pool. As a family, we're thinking about putting in a pool, we say.
Right.
We're thinking about it. We're discussing it. We're doing our research. And my wife will find the top pool companies.
There you go. Get a couple
then she'll schedule a meeting with the pool people. The pool people come over. They all give quotes. They all give references. And then my wife says this, Andrew. She says, I'm going to talk to my husband about it.
Mm.
Then she comes to me and she says, we're putting in a pool. And I say, all right. That's how it happens.
That's true.
And according to all the research out there, this is mind-blowing.
Yeah.
And I want you to put some show notes, put the stats on the show notes.
Got it.
But it's well over 3/4 of every single purchasing decision made in the continental United States is made by the wife.
Wow.
3/4 of all domestic spending decisions are made by women. 3/4. 3/4. That means what school are we going to put our kid in? What movie are we going to watch? How are we going to decorate the house? Andrew, do you remember being consulted about how to decorate anything?
Not so much, no.
And you guys, when you guys first got married, you bought a house.
That's true.
Did you move all your crap into the garage or the attic?
Into the room we never go into.
Right, because you're a man, which means that you have a one quarter. You have there's four people voting. There's four votes that are cast.
Right.
Two people voting, but four votes.
Yep.
And you have one.
I have one.
So majority rules every time.
This is true.
And that is how it works. And so, but if so, if you have an idiot spouse, seriously, if you're married to a moron, your life is a bad deal because it's every decision will be bad because you two will do your vote and it'll be always in the wrong direction.
It's true.
So if your spouse can't agree to delay gratification, you can't win. Spouse can't allow you to spend the time needed to grow the business, you can't win. And so today's guest, Jason Khalipa, this is the guy who won the 2008 CrossFit Games. His wife is awesome.
Wow.
She's an awesome wife.
There you go.
And he understands happy wife, Andrew, happy...
life.
Right. Happy wife, happy life. And he understands the equation, happy wife, happy life. She's a great lady. He's a great dude. And it works. But if you're out there today and you're a man and you say, I don't have a plan. My wife doesn't like me, I don't think. Well, what you need to do, and this is what I do every week, you go on a hot date, you book a hot date, Andrew.
Yep.
You get like a saxophone artist to come over to your house. You hire a saxophone guy to come to your house. It's kind of weird to have the long-haired saxophone guy at your dinner table, but he's playing, and you look over at your spouse and you say, what am I doing wrong? Mm. How can I get better? Mm. Andrew, try it with me. What am I doing wrong?
What am I doing wrong?
How can I do it better?
Can I do it better?
I don't sense any passion. It's like you're on a radio show being told to say it. Come on.
Okay. Oh.
Bring it. Yeah.
All right. So what am I doing wrong?
Mm.
How can I do it better?
That's really good. Because that's what happens. And the great thing is that every time I ask that question, my wife gives me constructive criticism, and then we get back to being normal. But it seems like about every 30 days, I just irritate her just to see what happens.
Yep.
That is a superpower that I have.
That's about the right ratio.
So if you're out there today, and you're finding yourself kind of doing battle with your spouse in the house about various things, listen to today's show with Jason Khalipa. This guy loves his wife, loves his family. He's a great entrepreneur, a great fitness expert. You're going to love this guy, Jason Khalipa. I mean, it seems like we married up, and your wife is a big encourager there. Can you talk to me about the role that she plays or has played in encouraging you throughout your entrepreneurial career?
Well, I mean, I think she her dad's an entrepreneur, and so I think she knows what she's getting herself into. And at a young age, I didn't really have the same entrepreneurial spirit or hard work ethic that I have today. And I think over the years, we've had certain life goals that we both wanted for our family, and she recognizes that we have to have some sacrifices in certain areas to get other things. And so, you know, we check in on a regular basis. We have regular date nights, which were really important for us, especially all the time we've spent in the hospital. And, we have regular check-ins about, hey, what are we trying to accomplish here? And one of the big things that we talked about recently was reaching our full potential. And so she's there to kind of help guide me and help me and her, both of us, reach our full potential as a couple and then also individually, which I think is really cool.
I don't want to get too deep into the weeds of the personal details of your date night, but a lot of entrepreneurs, we have, you know, about 500,000 folks that will download this podcast, you know, every month. And a lot of them are going, okay, date night, what kind of stuff do you guys do? You know what I mean? So what do you do? I mean, do you guys go out for Italian food? Do you go work out? Do you do pump it up? I mean, what do you guys do during your date night?
Oh, we're going out to a restaurant. We're having drinks. That's for sure. So, whether we were at the hospital, our family was very supportive and gave us date nights there. Or when we're at home, we have family that can help support with the kids, which is excellent. At least every weekend, we go on a date. And that could be as simple as going to a wine bar, having a couple glasses of wine. It could be, she's a big fan of margaritas and I like a little mezcal. And it's just, finding that balance in our relationship where we go out and when we first had kids, one of the things we told each other is that we wanted to have our relationship number one, and our children are our top priority. But if our relationship wasn't strong and if we didn't do the best we could to make sure that we are communicating well, then we wouldn't have a good relationship for our children. And so we make sure that, we're regularly communicating on an adult level every single weekend like that. That's critical for us over a couple of cocktails.
No, you, it's interesting. We talk about it on the show all the time. You want to have a great
family, you know, great faith relationship, great fitness relationship. It's the F6 life: faith, family, fitness, finances, friendship, fun. You seem like you guys, nobody's balanced, but I mean, you guys seem like you're really intentional about becoming as balanced as you could possibly be. Do you have certain books that have inspired your philosophy or mindset throughout the years?
You know, I've just had a lot of mentors. I've met with a lot of people, and I've learned a lot from them. People who are, you know, 10, 15 years older than me, and you start learning from some of their mistakes and some of their pitfalls. And I think regular daily check-ins on how you're doing on a micro level is a great place to start. This way you don't have these major, you know, kind of epiphanies 10 years later that you never had a good relationship with your kids or your wife. And I think that's just a daily check-in you could do. And then every now and then have these big check-ins where you kind of create goals together as a family.
So previous to winning the CrossFit Games, what was your occupation? What were you doing to support the family before becoming the CrossFit superstar that you are now today?
Well, I mean, back in 2008, I mean, I graduated college in 2008. So I graduated college, proposed to my wife, and won CrossFit Games all that same year. Before that, I was working a sales job at the gym while going through college. And so, you know, my big why was to be able to take Ashley out to, you know, dinners and stuff. But then once I won the CrossFit Games, I then opened up the business that same year. And ever since, we've been kind of doing our thing.
Now, Dr. Breck, for all the listeners out there that are not as familiar with you and your chiropractic center,
right?
What's your website and where are you located?
DrBreck.com. And we are located at 5401 South Sheridan, Suite 105, Tulsa, Oklahoma.
So let's say I'm listening today and I've got chronic back pain, or recently I've injured my back, mm-hmm. Or I'm just looking for a chiropractor that I can trust.
Or if you're stressed out and you don't want to be on these mind-altering drugs.
What kind of relief could you offer to our listeners?
We can relieve all kinds of things. So headaches, neck pain, back pain, things that people don't think about a lot of times are your hands, your feet, your knees, your ankles, you name it. We also treat little children.
Thrive Nation, you've heard it here. Check him out online today. That's drbreck.com, drbreck.com.
Live, local, casting from the center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters, it's the Thrive Time Show.
Sorry, we're going streaking through the quad and into the gymnasium. Come on, everybody! Come on, Snoop! Snoop-a-loop!
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to another exciting edition of the Thrive Time Show on your radio and podcast download. And in the studio today, we are joined here with Colton and Rusty, the owners of Justice Tumbling. It's a tumbling gym located right here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And guys, for all the listeners out there, Rusty, that are saying, hey, I have a daughter. They're into cheerleading. They're into tumbling. And I'm looking for someone to teach them private lessons or group classes. What is your website? And what's the no-brainer offer, Rusty, that you're offering right now over there at Justice Tumbling?
Nice. Our no-brainer right now is we are offering a free month of tumbling for just $1.
A free month?
Just $1.
Oh, and for just $1. So we got them for the whole month. I get it for $1.
You get one class a week for the entire month for just $1, and you can go to justicetumblingcompany.com.
Wow.
And get more info.
And Andrew, if you divide that by 30 days, it's like 3 cents a day.
Well,
for 3 cents a day, you can send
a deal.
Four cents a day, you could send your kids to tumbling class. That's a nice has a nice ring to it.
Yeah,
there.
It does.
Now we're interviewing today Jason Khalipa, who is known as being the champion CrossFit winner of the CrossFit Games, the 2008 winner of the CrossFit Games. And I want to ask you this, Colton: are you into CrossFit?
I have never been into CrossFit. No.
Do you know much about CrossFit at all?
Not much. I was in the Marine Corps, and so we did a little bit of stuff like that, but not like they do it today.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to queue up footage of Jason competing, and I would like for you, we'll just kind of do a color commentating and see if this is impressive to you, okay? So I'm queuing it up here, and let me queue it up. This is CrossFit. This is Jason Khalipa. It's K-H-A-L-I-P-A versus Rich Fronning, I believe, on the big screen. There he is. He's getting ready. This was, I think this was on ESPN here. Okay, here we go. Here we go. We're getting ready. Now, Jason Khalipa He's big, jacked guy. He's probably, I don't know what he weighs, just jacked guy. Going to get somebody else. And they're doing some kind of deadlift, I believe, here, where they're going to lift the weight. What do you call it when you lift the weight off the ground and then raise it over your head? What do you call that?
I believe that's a deadlift.
Okay, they're going to do a deadlift. Here we go. Here we go.
13.5 underweight.
They're going to lift it up like this.
On the left, Rich Froning.
Now, apparently they have to do some massive number of these. I don't know. I guess you keep points by whoever does the most reps. And then they go to pull-ups. Look at these pull-ups. Watch these pull-ups here. And they got to do like 20 pull-ups. Then they break for 10 seconds. They talk about their feelings. Now they're back into it again. Here we go. Oh, again. And then they're going back doing more pull-ups.
Non-stop.
And they're doing some more of this. And they're doing some more pull-ups. What do you guys think about that? Is CrossFit a sport in your mind?
I would say CrossFit is definitely a sport.
I got
intense.
Tired just watching him.
Andrew, is CrossFit a sport in your mind?
It looks like it.
If you were invited to go to the Winter Olympics to watch curling, you know, where you shove a piece of pottery on the ice and you sort of buff the ice with like a broom type of thing.
Sweep
Have
it
you
away.
Seen curling?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. If you could go, if you got asked, you said, hey, all expense trip to the Winter Olympics to go see curling. And you can only see the curling event or to go watch guys do the pull-ups and the deadlifts, the CrossFit. Which one would you rather go to and why, Andrew?
100% the CrossFit. There was so much energy there. Looks like a lot more fun than sitting and watching curling.
That's a very controversial take. No disrespect to the curling fans out there. Colton, back to you. If you were offered, hey, you get to go to see curling at its best, at its finest, at the Winter Olympics, all expenses paid. You can go for a week to see the Winter Olympics or a week to see the CrossFit Games. Which one would you rather go to?
Definitely the CrossFit. That was intense. It looked like a boxing match.
Yeah.
So you would go to that. You liked the energy.
It was high energy.
Okay. Well, we still have room for another. By the way, you get 2 mega points right there. Okay. Now, Rusty, want to get your take on this? Would you rather go see the CrossFit Games or curling in the Winter Olympics?
Definitely curling. No, I mean,
really? Whoa, no. Wow.
Definitely the CrossFit. And like Colton said, it seemed like it was a UFC fight or something that they were at.
Real quick, we had a CrossFitter that just called in, and luckily Andrew was able to cut them off before we got into the words they were using. But this is what they had to say about Rusty's take there. Okay, so we're going back into our interview with Mr. Jason Khalipa, the winner of the 2008 CrossFit Games. Tell the listeners out there who aren't as familiar with your story, tell them about the college you went to and then the business that you now have started.
So I went to a junior college for 2 years because I screwed up in high school and I was just not taking it seriously. And then I went to a 4-year university called Santa Clara University. That was excellent, where I graduated in 2008 with my wife and a few of our friends. And then that same year, you know, I won the CrossFit Games, but at the time there wasn't much money in it like there is today. And so I started up a business in a small warehouse, and then we had one location, then we expanded. Now we have, you know, 22 locations or so globally, and it's been a lot of fun, that's for sure.
Well, I know
a fun journey.
I know a lot of our listeners love to Google and kind of check in on our guests and, you know, pursue. What's the website where they can learn more about your 22 locations that you have today?
JasonKhalipa.com is a great location just to check out more about me and what we have going on.
Okay, now, for people out there that are going, okay, I'm probably going to pick up this guy's book. I mean, this guy, I want to buy his books, book as many reps as possible. We're going on to chapter 3 here, and I want to kind of get into chapter 3 of the book. Your book is filled with so many knowledge bombs. As you began to put this book together, did you have a mentor helping you or an agent that helped you? Because a lot of people are just overwhelmed by the idea of writing a book.
When I first sat down to write an idea for a book, what I told myself is that I wanted to put out a book that was kind of what I saw in the marketplace. So what happened was is that I'd be traveling, you know, a lot. This year so far, I've traveled 100 days this year.
Whoa.
100 days plus. And before I wrote this book in 2015, I was traveling more than that. And I was opening locations throughout Asia and all over the place. And I'd be at the airports. I'd look for, you know, motivation. I'd look for inspiration. And I'd pick up these books, and the books just didn't align with what I thought. Most of the time, they're talking about hacks and, you know, work less, get paid more. And I started to say to myself, you know, whatever happened, roll up your sleeves and get to work. And so I set out to write a book. at that time I had a ghostwriter. And then my daughter got sick like a month later, and it just totally transformed my reason for writing the book. That it went away from hey, let's write an hard work book, into hey, let's talk about this mindset of AMRAP mentality, and how, because I embraced it for so many years in my life, it allowed me to, the night she got diagnosed, to write an email and just say, hey guys, right now I have one focus and one focus only. And, you know, I had other competent people to take care of the business. We had built up a financial hedge, and my fitness is on point. My relationships are on point because we had developed as many reps as possible mindset. And so that's what I wanted to write. And so I basically scratched the ghostwriter, rewrote the whole thing myself, and then had some help with editing.
And how did you go about? We have a lot of our listeners that are best-selling authors, and we have we've had Seth Godin on the show and John Maxwell, and a lot of big names. You know, and what was your process for finding an agent that understood you and what you were trying to do?
Well, so I didn't really go through an agency, so I decided to self-publish, and I kind of had a hybrid where this group they print the book for me and they kind of store it, and then but I self-published it, but I found a ghostwriter just through mutual friends. But again, you know, this book was written by me through all my travels to Asia. I would just sit down for like 12, 15 hour flights and just write it. And then I had one of the people on our team who's a former lawyer who could write really well, help me edit it out. And so that was my way of doing it. And the reason why I wanted to self-publish is because I already have a little bit of a social reach.
Yeah.
And I wanted to donate. You know, like, we're donating all the proceeds from pre-sales, which are through January 8th. And then after that, we're donating a portion. So basically, I wanted to try and get as much money as possible for the kids to support pediatric cancer. And I didn't want to go through traditional publishing and give them a percentage.
Where does where do you donate to? Like, if someone buys your book right now, because there's a lot of people are going to go right now. And right now, just go up there. They're going to go on Amazon and they're going to buy as many reps as possible. Where does the money go to? The donations.
Yeah, I truly hope to do. I hope to get value out of it. It's a short read, you know, 2 hours. It's designed to be impactful. And the money goes to an organization called NIGU, which is a Never Ever Give Up organization. So it's NIGU.org. And the story there is we've been donating there. My wife and I also host an event called Ava's Kitchen. And we donate all the proceeds to NIGU, where we manage a fund within their fund. Said this way, there's a lot of checks and balances. We make sure every penny goes to kids fighting cancer.
That's great.
And to give families really cool events, to, you know, help with financial needs. There's all kinds of stuff we do. But NIGU is a great organization, and we stand behind them.
If you're out there today saying, you know what, I don't have a proactive accountant to start this new year, I want to make a lot of new changes. I want to become a more proactive person, and I do not have a proactive accountant helping me with a proactive tax strategy, I would encourage you to check out our good friends and show sponsors at hoodcpas.com.
Get ready to enter the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170. Uh-huh.
It's all about the Benjamins, baby.
Thrive Nation, are you out there starting this new year saying to yourself, you know what, I am going to get in shape. I'm going to do it. This is the year, Andrew, this is the year I'm going to get in
this
shape.
This is it.
I'm not going to be in shape anymore. No. Done with the pear shape. Done with the, you know, the eggplant shape.
Eggplant.
I'm done with the eggplant and the pear shape. I'm done with the gourd shape. I'm done with all that. I want to be in shape.
Mm.
So maybe you're looking at different options, and maybe you actually stumbled across a CrossFit. Maybe you're a big CrossFit advocate listening today. Maybe you're aware of what CrossFit is. Maybe, how about this? How many listeners do we have that are here? Okay, that's good. So on today's show, we're interviewing the winner of the 2008 CrossFit Games. The champion every year, when they have a champion, they name this champion they win the title as the fittest man on earth. The fittest man on earth. Not only did he become the fittest man on earth, but he went on, Mr. Jason Khalipa, to open up a gym called NC Fit with 6 profitable locations, 5 in California, and 1 in Mexico. And now, without any further ado, back to our interview with Jason Khalipa. You know, chapter 3 of your book, you talk about the next level focus. What does that mean?
So what that means is that, you know, for a lot of years, I was focusing on things that were outside my control. And it caused me to not perform well because I'd be worrying about the events or my competitors. And so I used so much energy focusing on other things that I forgot about what was actually mattering, which was, hey, my warm-up, my execution, my training. And so next level focus is really about identifying what's in your control versus out of your control, making sure you focus on what's in your control. And a great way to do that is just to take two circles with anything that's upsetting you or stressing you out, and just take all the things that are in your control, put them in the left circle, take all the things that are out of your control, put them in the right circle. And that's a great, great first step. And I think I did that with competing. And then I did that with my daughter getting leukemia. I did that in business. And, you know, for example, I got word yesterday that another gym wants to open up literally next to one of our locations.
There we go.
And at first I was super frustrated, right? I called the future owner. I said, hey man, I think you're making a big mistake. Let me explain why. Right. And I explained why. But then after a while I went to dinner with the kids, my wife, and I sat there. I was like, look, it's completely outside my control. I can't determine what this guy's going to do. I already called and said my piece. Now let me go ahead and just, spend time with the family. And that was it. I just turned it off that quickly. And that's an easy way to do it.
Thrive Nation, those of you who listen to the show regularly, you know, my partner, Dr. Zellner, and I, we own 13 multimillion-dollar companies, just like you, multiple locations, Jason, a lot of different businesses, brick and mortar. And when you have somebody that leases space, a landlord or a property owner that leases to your direct competition, you know, very closely to you, or that can be frustrating. The fact that you got over that so quick, that's a powerful moment. I mean, you're able to put that into a different part of your brain, compartmentalize it, and move on. That right there, we should probably put that on repeat, Andrew, until our brains explode.
Yeah.
Now, chapter four. Go for it. Sorry.
Well, and a great way to develop that, you know, just to be clear, I mean, obviously I'm a huge fitness advocate, but I think that it's a great tool set to develop in your garage where you're going through a workout. You have to overcome adversity to identify what's in your control, what's out of your control for that event. And just, you know, you can learn it through working out so easily, and it translates so well. It doesn't happen overnight, but it's a, you know, it's all about consistency there. It's understanding when something's really frustrating you. What can you do about it? If nothing, then move on. That's it. Nothing else to say.
Now, I know you have a hot date night planned tonight here, so I have three final questions for you. Three final questions
in our
speed round here. Chapter four, you give all the listeners out there a very powerful, Andrew, this is almost like a get rich, not quick. This is like a get rich slow tip. And Andrew, you hear all the guests we have, David Robinson, NBA Hall of Famer, Lee Cockrell, managed Disney World, John Maxwell, Seth Godin, all these people, they all basically give the same get rich slow. But I think this guy, I think Jason really nails it here. Chapter four, you titled it, "The Only Real Life Hack, Work Really Hard."
Yeah. Well, it's the truth. You know, I think everybody's so, especially with social media these days, they go on there and they want instant gratification, right? They want to show up in the Bahamas, you know, being in a yacht overnight. And it just doesn't happen that way. You know, people don't put up their struggles. People don't put up all the adversity that overcome, and people don't put up the decades of hard work. And I think what's really important for people to remember is that I started in the fitness industry at the age of 15, working the front desk, and then I got into sales. And now at 33, you know, I have all these years under my belt where I've been learning from mentors. I've been focused on one thing, which is the fitness space. And I haven't been going from one area to the next. I've been really diligent on this particular, you know, I know a lot about fitness. I don't know much about, you know, the restaurant business, for example.
Right.
And so I think it's really important that people, before they get into a business, they just remind themselves, like, hey, have I earned the confidence? Have I earned the right to open this? What is my competitive advantage? Have I put in the work? And if they have, well, then I could think they're going to be a lot more successful. But if you just want to tell yourself you want to open it, but you can't really back it up with years of dedication and hard work, I think you're setting yourself up for a more challenging situation. And so, to summarize, whether you want to win at, you know, a professional sport or you want to win at business, I think that it takes years and years and years of this slow, consistent effort.
True.
I think it's critical.
All right, two final questions for you here. Andrew, I did some Googling. We did some Googling.
Yeah, we did.
The team, just so you know, Jason, we've got about 50 people that work at the Thrivetime show. And then in all the companies, there's hundreds of people. I think the Christmas party, there's probably 400 people at the party. A lot of people there. And we did some Googling, and we're going, wow,
this guy seems to be in shape. So I want to ask you, on a daily basis, what does your diet look like today?
Yeah, I mean, so I try and eat real food, right? I think that's the first key, is that take out, you know, soda. I think that's a very easy thing to do. Avoid these excessive amounts of sugar. Try and just eat real food throughout each of your meals.
Yep.
And start there. But I think the key is consistency. And so it means eating real food, you know. And look, if you show up at a party and someone wants to eat a piece of cake and it's your kid's birthday, go ahead and eat some cake. Don't be so crazy about it. But it's that consistency piece of eating well and exercising hard for at least, you know, these 30 minutes to an hour a day, getting into the gym, surrounding yourself with like-minded people who want to push themselves, and let's get after it. And I think that mindset of just every day, eat real food, work out hard at least once a day, make sure you're moving and hydrating. And I think you're setting yourself up for success because, look, I don't want to be fit for the next month. I want to be fit for the rest of my life. And so for me, it's this distant horizon. Just like, you know, creating a really big business takes time. Fitness takes a while. But then once you get there, it's just this constant goal to maintain and continue to develop. And so for me, it combines two things. Consistent workouts every day where I push myself,
yep,
mentally and physically, and then eating real food.
And I want to make sure that I tried to watch as many videos as I could that you've talked to, you know, done interviews. You've done countless interviews. If the listeners out there will avoid sweets, right? Just avoid just eating, yeah, you know, sugary beverages. Don't drink your calories, right? I mean, just don't drink sugar. Don't eat sugar. Just don't, right? Sugar, sort of avoid that.
Yeah. I mean, 100%. I mean, I think, you know, not only is it going to, you know, absorb in your bloodstream really, really quick and, you know, spike your blood sugar levels, but I just think it's just a waste, you know, spend it on something else. Avoid soda is just a really easy thing to do.
Got it.
Switch over to sparkling water. It's a great next step, right? I mean, it gets you the carbonation and it removes a lot of the sugar.
Final question for you. Final 90 seconds. I know you got to go on that hot date. So here we go. How do you spend the first 4 hours of your typical day?
That's a great question. So I get asked a lot about my evening routine and my morning routine. My evening routine, I don't really have one because I fall asleep so quickly. It takes me less than 2 minutes to fall asleep, so I don't really need to worry about that. I know some people need to wind down. For me, it doesn't happen that way. But my morning routine, something I've been playing with, is every morning I work out. So I go in my garage, I get on my, you know, I do some form of cardio.
What time?
20, 30 minutes, just kind of. This is around 6. So I go to bed every night between 10 and 11 at the latest. Like, and I wake up every day around anywhere between 5:30 and 6:30 is traditionally where I'm at. And I'll go in the garage, I'll hit some cardio, and I've been playing around with cold plunging, and I'm going to play around with the sauna. So right now what I'm doing is I go in the garage, I just turn on a clock, I don't think, I just start moving. And in the beginning I feel like, you know, not good. But then after a few minutes I start moving a little bit. And I think for any CEO, any entrepreneur out there, just get a spin bike, throw it in your living room. You know, don't check your phone. Just get on and start moving. Get in 15, 20, 30 minutes of hard effort and then go on and go do the rest of your gig. And if you want to start doing cold plunge, right now I'm in California, so it's not too, too cold, but it's still cold and we don't heat our pool. So something I've been working on is getting in there for 20 to 30 deep breaths until I can control my heart rate again and my breathing. And it just kind of shocks my system, gets me going for the rest of the day. That's what I've been playing with right now.
Where in California do you live? Southern California or?
Northern California, like the San Jose Bay Area.
Oh boy, you do have a cold pool.
Yes, I mean it's kind of cold. I mean, you know, right now I'm in Scottsdale, Arizona. Actually, I road trip down here with my son. He's 4 and a half, and that was kind of cool. And now we met my wife and daughter, and now we're road tripping back up. It's gonna be fun.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to let you and your wife and your son get back to that great family event. I cannot tell you how much we appreciate you for taking time out of your busy schedule to share your insights and your words of wisdom with the Thrive Nation. And Thrive Nation, I'm not going to go out there and, you know, say you are a horrible person if you don't buy Jason's new book. I wouldn't say if you don't buy as many reps as possible, Andrew, you're a bad person.
No.
Some would suggest I should say that, but I would not allow that. I would just say, why don't you buy the book? Come on, just don't go to Starbucks twice. Buy the book. He's donating a lot of the proceeds to a great cause. Jason, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Yeah, I really, really appreciate you having me on. If anybody wants to, you know, stay up to date on what I have going on, jasonklieba.com and Jason Klieba on Instagram is probably going to be the best spot. And, you know, feel free to DM me if you have any questions. I would really, really, really appreciate your support on the book, and I hope you can get, you know, an impact from it.
Have a blessed night, my friend. We will talk to you soon.
All right. Thank you so much.
Take care. Andrew, have you ever competed in CrossFit?
Have not actually competed.
You ever thought of competing in CrossFit?
No.
In CrossFit?
Never have I, ever.
I'm afraid of the word CrossFit.
Yeah.
That guy's a scary dude. Check him out online. His name is Jason Khalipa. We'll put a link to all of his information on today's show notes. And I want to encourage everybody, because at the time of this recording, we're in the new year now. We're in the new year. And so many people think it's not possible to achieve success. They say, I want to achieve success, but it's not possible for me because... whatever.
Yeah.
A lot of people have told me recently, I can't achieve success because I'm overeducated.
There you go.
I have an MBA.
That's a good excuse.
She has an MBA. We all have MBAs. They're passing out MBAs. We have too much education, too much debt. Well, we have a listener out there by the name of Rachel, and her husband's his name is Tyler. So it's Rachel and Tyler, and they're based in New Orleans.
Yep.
And they reached out to us about 3 years ago, and they had a company called Delrick Clinical Research.
Great company.
Now, some people might say you have to have revenue to have a company, but no, they had a pre-revenue company, we'll call it. It's a pre-revenue company. A lot of expenses on the spreadsheet, a lot of on the balance sheet, a lot of expenses, not a lot of income. And they reached out to us, and that was about almost 2.5-3 years ago.
Right.
And now we are proud to say that Delrick Research, and we'll put a link to it on the show notes, Delrick Research is now producing a profit per month, Andrew, of over $100,000.
Whoa.
That's per month. Now, Andrew.
That's crazy.
Now, it's a husband-wife team, so they split it in half. They each have only $50,000 a month of disposable income now.
Only.
So they're going through a tough time.
Tough time.
They only have $100,000 a month to spend on themselves. Yep. So we're going to start kind of a GoFundMe, I think. Maybe.
Okay. Yeah.
So if you're out there and you're saying, how are people supposed to get by on $100,000 a month?
I couldn't do it.
Maybe we could get the GoFundMe account going. It could go viral. Maybe they could then have $200,000 a month.
There you go.
But in all sincerity, they're doing very well. Their company's called Delrick Research. It's Delrick. They're a clinical research company. And when we come back from the break, we're going to tell you their story. Stay tuned. You're listening to the Thrivetime Show on your radio and podcast download at thrivetimeshow.com.
Get ready to enter the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170. Oh.
I highly recommend that all the listeners listen to that song, by the way. It's called Delta 1406. It's written by Mike Posner. It's a song about Mike Posner was a college student going to Duke University, Andrew. Duke University.
Duke University.
And in that university dorm room, he produced beats for Big Sean and other rappers.
Ah.
He ended up scoring a meeting with Jay-Z at the time and other record labels because his YouTube remakes were taking off and doing so well. And he looked up and realized, gosh, I'm not like a normal college student anymore. So what happened was is he became very, very successful very quick. And he wrote this song. I'll cue it up real quick. It's called Cooler Than Me by Mike Posner. And this was the song that made him famous. So this is the song that took off. And I'll cue ahead to the part everyone knows here. Here we go. Bup, 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 bup. I need more cowbell on the track. There it is. Oh. So he's a college student, and he's making millions of dollars, and he realizes, geez, all of a sudden girls that wouldn't talk to me now like me.
Yep.
All of a sudden people that I didn't even know now hate me because they criticize my music.
Yeah.
All of a sudden I've got tons of downloads on iTunes. He's filling up a concerts, and he's doing songs with Lil Wayne. He did songs with Maroon 5, Mike Posner. Had a lot of success. But that song is about sitting back and going, am I happy where I am? And in Mike's case, he got to a place where he openly said he was not happy where he was.
Hmm.
Talked about how he's too famous to be a normal person anymore.
Right.
But he doesn't want to be famous anymore. And his whole life was different. It wasn't how he wanted it to be. So I'm asking the listeners out there as we start this new year to think about your life. Think about your life for a second and think about, am I going where I want to go? Because when I built DJ Connection, it was huge. We're doing 4,000 events a year.
Yep.
I didn't want it. I wish I wouldn't have built it the way I did. Because I was personally booked 250 shows a year.
Yep. took a lot of your time.
Do you realize how many shows a year that is?
It's a lot.
Five shows a week, bro. That's crazy. Like, that's, I mean, wow. I mean, Valentine's, New Year's. Every event, I did every date 1 year, every holiday except for Christmas. I did Christmas Eve. Oh, yeah. I did a wedding on Christmas Eve. I did Thanksgiving, all of them.
Wow.
And if you're not careful, man, you can end up spending your whole life building a schedule that you don't like, yep, and a life you don't like. So I would like to ask you this, Andrew.
Okay.
And then I'm going to pick on Colton next.
Got it.
And then Rusty can one-up us. So Colton and Rusty are partners. They own a company called Tumbling Smart. Andrew is a Thrivetime show producer.
Wrong name.
What's that?
Wrong name.
Oh, wrong name.
Yeah. Not Tumbling Smart.
Justice.
Justice.
Not Tumbling Justice. Smart.
That would be our competitor.
How about this? If you want to tumble smart, go to Justice Tumbling.
There you go.
That's perfect.
There it is. In my face. Okay, so Andrew, back to you. In my face. How about this? I want to make sure all the listeners get it. Justice Tumbling. Justice Tumbling. Andrew said me, Justice Tumbling. We're creating new neural pathways. Okay, so back to you. What are your goals, my friend? What are your goals for this next year that you want to share on the air?
Some of my goals would be to continually growing the relationship with my wife as we go into our second year of marriage this next year. So continuing date nights and
hey, clean it up there, buddy. Okay, continue. Sorry.
And optimizing both of our schedules to be able to spend the time we would like to spend together with each other. So that's one of our big goals, and one of our more long-term goals is to work together.
Okay. So you have thought about these goals.
Yep.
And how old are you right now?
I'm 20 years old.
And what percentage of your income do you now save?
25%.
Of every dollar that comes in?
Of every dollar.
And you own one rent house, don't you?
I do.
And that's crazy. And how old are you?
I am 20. And we're working on getting more in this upcoming year. That's one of our goals.
That is crazy. So maybe you've flown too far. Maybe you've already hit your peak there. Okay.
There's no way I'm one-upping that.
So that's your goal for the year. That's impressive. That's your goal. And you're 20?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Colton, I want to ask you, what's your vision for Justice Tumbling?
Well, my vision for Justice Tumbling is to franchise out. We want to be the biggest, best tumbling gym in the entire world.
In the world.
In the world.
And I believe that it can happen.
I believe it can happen.
I know that our photography company, Epic Photos, became the largest in the industry for weddings. DJ Connection became the largest. OxyFresh, who I work with, is now the largest carpet cleaning franchise. They're all designs of a decade, though. You know, they're kind of a decade plan. Do you have any midterm goals for this year where you go, at the end of this year, this is where we want to be? Have you guys talked about that there?
We have. We have. We want to have a second location.
Okay.
So right now we're in the northeastern side of Tulsa.
Yeah, got it.
Closer to Broken Arrow. And then next year we want to be south towards Jinx and Glimpel.
Okay, now, Rusty, feel free to one up your partner here at Justice Tumbling.
Yeah, we definitely want to grow. Like he said, we want our name when it comes to tumbling to be the standard for tumbling technique. We want the athletes that come in the gym to have a family environment. We both have families. We want the kids to feel comfortable and have a place to tumble.
So let's ratchet it down now to small goals. Mm. So daily, Andrew, how often do you hear me just badgering clients about calling their leads?
Daily.
How often do you hear me badgering clients about getting Google reviews?
All the time.
How often do you hear me badgering clients about doing podcasts?
Pretty often.
Can I blow your mind for a second, Andrew?
Go for it.
Do you realize that Rusty and Colton here with Justice Tumbling, these guys... I said, guys, you know what we need to do? We met at the conference. So what we need to do is we need to do a podcast every day.
Every day.
Every day. If we're going to be top in the world.
Got to be top.
Because it comes down to who has the most content.
Yep.
Whoever has the most canonical compliance, the most mobile compliance, and the most reviews. And these guys, Andrew, would you believe that they have done a podcast every day?
I after meeting them, I would.
Since the last time I saw you guys, it was 14 days ago.
That's correct.
How many podcasts have you done?
14 podcasts. Oh.
Nobody does that. Nobody does. Nobody does.
Holy cow.
It's so good. It's so good.
Oh, Billy.
Nobody does that. If everybody would do that, it would be so awesome. You know, Thrive Nation, if you want to become a non-successful person, I've got 8 tips, okay, for not being successful. Tip number one. Don't do what you're supposed to do. Tip number two, talk about your feelings all the time. Tip number three, talk about politics. Tip number four, talk about religion. Tip number five, pray for things you could do yourself. Tip number six, make excuses. Tip number seven, sleep in a lot. And tip number eight, for being a non-successful, pathetic loser in 2019.
Probably my best tip is tip number eight. Always keep bags of your own poop. Collect it throughout your stay and just have it ready.
That is the tips for not being successful in 2019. But if you want to be successful, you got to put in the practice. You got to put in the work. You got to do it. And if you want your kids to get better at tumbling, you got to put in the practice and you got to put in the work. And for all that is good and holy, make a smart decision and go to Justice Tumbling. That's Justice Tumbling. I like the name Justice. And now that I've visually kind of seared it to my head.
Yeah.
It's almost like a Marvel comic is how I'm picturing it. Justice Tumbling. Check them out online. They're a great company. Great guys. When we come back from the break, we're going to tell you about a company called Delrict Research, started by Tyler and Rachel. These guys were a startup just less than 3 years ago, and now they're making $100,000 a week. $100,000 a month.
A month.
$100,000 a month of profit at DelrictResearch.com. Stay tuned.
Live, local. Get ready to enter the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Andrew, I want to dedicate this song to you right now. I'm going to get my cowbell, kind of all the Thrivers out there getting their cowbell ready. Andrew, all the Thrivers are dedicating this song to you.
That's cool.
They love you.
Never heard that song.
Really?
Never.
It's What I Like by Bruno Mars. I believe that he wrote it for you.
Oh.
So I hate to be the one to break the news to you, but you're sort of a big deal, and he loves your body. Okay.
Wow.
Now, on today's show, we're talking about how you can become successful in 2019. You can do it. But to build your faith, we asked a member of the Thrive Nation, a member of the Thrive Time Show community, Delrict and Rachel with it's a Tyler and Rachel with DelrictResearch.com.
Yep.
We asked them to share about their successes during the past 3 years. And they literally have gone from a startup to making $100,000 a month of profit. And this has been their experience with the Thrive Time Show coaching program.
My name is Tyler Hastings, and this is my wife, Rachel. And our company is Delrict Research out of New Orleans. During our time working with Thrive, we've had numerous successes. When we first started, we were working with one physician, we had one research site, and we were seeing on average, you know, between 10 and 15 patients a week. Since working with Thrive in the last 18 months, we now have four research sites. We work with over five physicians, and on average, we're now seeing over 60 patients per week. Recently, we've been the top enroller worldwide in seven studies, which is just incredible considering where we were, you know, 2 years ago, 18 months ago.
Thrive really differs from the other conferences that we've been to and the other kind of programs that we've been through because they actually really practice what they preach and they implement the same systems and the processes that they teach you about, and they give you real life examples that have really worked for them and show you with the training how to implement that yourself. For example, Tyler and I actually got the opportunity to come out to Tulsa, and we're fortunate enough that the Thrive team took us out to some of the businesses that they own, and we really got to see in real life, real time, some of the systems and processes, and it was just incredible. A real life example of some of the businesses and the things that they're implementing.
Having a coach is important to us. They act as not only an accountability factor, but they're someone we can talk to on a daily basis as we go through the problems of running a business that inevitably come up. They always understand what we're going through, and they're always there to, you know, help us or guide us through the problems that we experience. The best part of our experience working with Thrive has just been seeing our relationship grow. So at each step, as our business grows, you know, they have something else to provide us with. They've got the resources, whether it be marketing, graphic design, website development, or even into accounting practices. Maybe we need a new insurance policy. They have someone they can connect us with, or, you know, they have the direct resource we need to speak with for any of the problems we face. If someone's thinking about signing up for the coaching program, I would highly recommend that they call in for a free 30-minute coaching session and see exactly what the team can do for you. Just speak with someone, let them know what you're going through, and I think you'll find that, you know, regardless of what you need, there's someone there that can help you.
Andrew, I think there's got to be a listener out there who says, you know what, that's cool that they're making $100,000 a month of profit, but you know what, I'm in a different industry. You know, I'm a different guy. I'm an automotive repair guy. I repair cars.
Yep.
Therefore, my world is different. You could not possibly understand how different it is. And I would say, oh, contraire there, my friend. We have a testimonial from a good friend named Guy Shepherd, a Thrivetime Show coaching client based in Oklahoma City, who heard about us from his friend Luke Owens, who owns the Hub Gym. And he has had dramatic success this year. And to build your faith, I pummel you with another testimonial and case study from a real thriver out there just like you. Just as tumbling. How would you describe your coaching experience with Chup for all of our listeners? And so Chup can hear that. How would you describe that
butter
relationship
Chup
you have with Eric?
You mean butter
Chup?
Well, I appreciate you giving me this opportunity, Clay, because I would, I'm amazed at how well you guys match up your coaches with your clients, because I feel like Eric has just been, perfect. And the way that he has helped me the most is he is my coach, but he's also treated me like a teammate a lot and said, man, you can do this, keep going. And yeah, it's tough, but hang in there. He's just really good. I mean, he's just been able to come alongside me where I'm at and challenge me to be better. At the same time, keep me encouraged. It's like our personalities are a lot alike, and sometimes he'll chew my ass, but sometimes it's he knows what I need that day. So I appreciate him since you give me this opportunity, I just want to say happy birthday, Chup. Appreciate you.
Thank you, brother.
Now, so for the listeners out there who are sarcastic, Captain Sarcasmo, who's listening, and he goes, that is great that you like Eric as a human and that you guys have a camaraderie and that he's helped you. But what specific wins have you had? Has it been search engine optimization? Has it been increased sales? Has it been a rash of complaints? I mean, what has been the big
specialty?
What are the big tangible benefits you've seen since working with Eric Chup?
Well, one big one is we have seen, since I started with you guys and started with Chup, we have seen a 59% increase in new customers.
Wow.
In the last year, over the previous year, a 59% increase in the number of new customers through our door. So, and that's huge.
The average American business grows at a 3% rate. If they don't go out of business, according to Forbes, 8 out of 10 businesses go out of business. And the average American business that is in business grows at a rate of 3% according to the gross domestic product. So 59%. See, I'm not a huge math guy, but I take 59.
These are normal size.
You're throwing numbers right at me.
That means you're growing at 19.6 times faster than the average American business. 19.6. What other wins have you experienced?
It's been huge. Just teaching me how to do a checklist. Teaching me the basics of, Google Sheets, just real basic stuff. I mean, it's kind of like, Clay, when you interview people and you say, hey, break down your morning routine for me. What exactly do you do to get your day started? Well, Chup has helped me with the basics. Okay, this is a Google Sheet. This is a Google document. This is how you do it. This is how you set up your task list. This is how you set up the company task list. And I needed that because I'm not a tech guy. I can work hard and all that, but all of this stuff is really new for me. And he's just been great at being practical and showing me detailed steps of how to get it done.
Do you need to build an office building? Are you trying to expand your church? Are you looking to build a school? Do you want to add on to your restaurant or build a new restaurant? Are you in need of a reliable commercial contractor with over 20 years of experience? Of course you are. And that's why I would encourage you to check out our good friends and show sponsors at Williams Contracting. That's Williams Contracting. You can check them out online at will-con.com. That's will-con.com. And if you go there today, what they're going to do is they're going to take the time to talk to you, to figure out your goals, your wants, and your needs, and they're going to get you a realistic budget within 3 days. Work with a contractor that will get your project done on time and on budget. That's will-con.com. Will-con.com.
Bada bing, bada boom. Stay tuned.
You have questions? America's number one business coach has answers. It's your Broda from Minnesota. Here's another edition of Ask Clay Anything on the Thrivetime Business Coach Radio Show.
Andrew, it's 2019, my friend.
Oh, and
next
incredible.
Week, Dr. Zellner will rejoin us on the show. Next week, we'll have Eric Chupp back on the show. Next week, a lot of things are going to change. Andrew, what are you most excited about in 2019? What are you most excited about?
Oh, man. 2019, just what I'm going to learn and the growth that I will have with working with the Thrivetime show.
Well, brother, I'm excited to have you on the team. You're making huge improvements. It's fun to have you. And I'm so glad your wife got to attend the New Year's Eve party with
yeah,
you.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Did you guys have fun?
It was a ton of fun. It was fun burning that tree.
That tree went up fast, did
that
it not?
That tree went up.
Every year I burn my Christmas tree, Thrive Nation. Every year it is an epic burn. It is unbelievable. Now, we have Colton and Rusty on today's show. And these guys have started a company called Justice Tumbling. And you guys get to ask me any business questions that you want during the final 6 or 7 minutes of today's show. So what question do you have, Mr. Colton?
Okay, so we deal with athletes and parents, teenage athletes, elementary school athletes. We're trying to stay relevant
with
the teenagers.
Got it.
While also appealing to parents.
Got it.
What is the best way to do that? Is that social media? Is that trying to post as much as we can on social media? Or is that trying to appeal more to parents with our website and the luxuries that we have at our gym for the parents?
Great question. I think it's pretty easy for me to answer it because I've worked with a lot of gyms, so I'll give it to you. One is like all the t-shirts you make.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the kids have to want to wear them. So I'd recommend you go into the stores where the teenagers, like if your average tumbling client is, let's say, between ages of like 10 and 18. Mm-hmm. You know, they're, are they mostly girls?
Mostly.
So I would go into, you know, the places where they shop and make sure that the shirts you're selling are the kind of shirts they would wear. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So the logos, the branding, all that, it's designed for them, not for you, you know?
Yeah.
The overhead music, I'd make sure it's the clean versions. And by the way, we talked about today.
We did.
You can tap into the, if you go to EITRLounge.com, everybody out there listening today, if you go to EITRLounge.com and you click on Clay Clark Radio, I have curated a playlist of music that's fun, it's upbeat, it's all edited, it's all top 40 hits, and I think everybody here would benefit by having upbeat music in your gym. That's one, that's two. So the shirts, the overhead music. I would make sure that the entire atmosphere, the decor, is on point with what the kids want.
Okay.
So, you know, if you go into like a Starbucks, or you go into, have you guys been into the new Warby Parker store or the new, any stores on Brookside, maybe Dr. Zellner's optometry clinic? You've been to like a new store where it's, have you seen kind of the on-trend stores that maybe, what's the by Guthrie Green? The exposed brick, the reclaimed wood.
Yeah. Industrial-like.
Yeah, the elephant in the room stores. They call it modern rustic.
Oh, there you go.
I would make sure that everything you do is modern rustic.
Okay.
Barnwood everywhere if you can, Edison bulbs when possible. And then as far as on social media, most of the younger demographic identifies right now with Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
So I would post on Instagram and Facebook so the parents and the kids can see you. But I would post, you know, on there a daily post. And then I would just make sure that you're really in tune with the kids right there. But in terms of like, the person paying you, it's probably always going to be the adult, or at least the vast majority of the students will be the adult.
It
will
is.
Be their parents will be paying you,
right?
And I would just make sure that as far as with them, that you offer lessons that start on time. Parents have a huge issue with lessons that start late and end late. I would start on time. I would embrace automatic recurred billing. I would take credit cards only, and I would make sure it's impeccably clean at all times so it inspires confidence. That's what I would do.
Sounds good.
What is a question, Rusty, that you have? You can ask any question that you want about your business, any question you have, my friend. You have the floor.
All right. I've always been a grinder trying to get clients in the building, getting more into the business side, finding a passion for that. Other than reading your books, I don't have much knowledge or any book ideas. What is a book or your top book that you would refer to a new business owner?
And I'm not passively aggressively dodging your question. So first, I would say here are the books I would read. I would definitely read Think and Grow Rich. It is the number one book everyone should read to get the mindset of an entrepreneur. Think and Grow Rich. I would definitely read Soft Selling in a Hard World by Vass, V-A-S-S, Jerry Vass, because that book teaches you the linear process of sales. It teaches you the technique of sales. It's not a personality type. It's a system. I'd read Purple Cow Marketing by Seth Godin, Purple Cow, because it explains how you have to be remarkable to stand out in a cluttered marketplace. I would read The Ultimate Sales Machine by Chet Holmes. The Ultimate Sales Machine by Chet Holmes has a red cover because it explains to you how to build a sustainable schedule that works. I would read Scale by Jeff Hoffman. He started Priceline, and he's going to be on the show here, by the way. He'll be on the show very soon. Jeff Hoffman with Priceline. It's called Scale. He teaches you how to build scalable systems and processes. Those would be the books I would really get intense about. I would just devour those. And then PR. It's Michael Levine's PR book. Michael Levine spoke at the conference, and he's written many, many books. Let me get the actual title here for you of the book that I'd recommend. Because there's so many of his books that I've read, but let me find it here real quick here. On the spot, Google search results. Can he do it? Can he do it? He has very limited time, and it's not exciting to hear somebody do Google searches. Let me try to find it. Here we go. Michael Levine. Is it coming up here? Michael Levine. I'm not finding it here. Let me see if I can find it. PR, Michael Levine. Oh, Billy, it's on the shelf over there somewhere. Andrew, talk about something. I'm going to grab the book. Talk about anything, Andrew. Talk about something.
Oh, man. We actually had Michael Levine at the conference, and it was phenomenal. He had a really good speech that he went over.
Oh, that was great filler. Okay, PR, Gorilla PR 2.0. Gorilla PR 2.0 is the best PR book on the planet. That book is great. And then 21, The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell. That is the book you need to read if you want to lead. The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership by John Maxwell, who we will have on the show here on February 5th. And then I would read for time management, Lee Cockerell's book called Time Management Magic. Time Management Magic by Lee Cockerell. He used to run Walt Disney World Resorts. He has been on the podcast multiple times. And those would be the books that I would devour those. And then you gotta drink a lot of Red Bull to read this book, because it really is a tough read, but it's awesome. It's called The Service Profit Chain. The Service Profit Chain. It was put out by the Harvard University, and it teaches you how to build a scalable business, but explains to you how your service has to be world class in order to get a premium brand built. But it explains to you all the steps you need to take to do that. Perfect. And so what I did to make your life easier, because I've read all these books, is I put them all into one book and gave you a Cliff Notes version of it. And that's what the Start Here book is. And you can download that for free at ThriveTimeShow.com. And that's what the Start Here book is. It's like the Cliff Notes version. Have you downloaded that, or have you guys read that?
That's the one I don't have.
You have got that book?
I downloaded it. Yes, I did.
Have you? It's all cited in there, so it references these books.
Okay.
But that's what I would check out. Any other final question, Colton? You have a chance to ask one more question here as we wrap up today's new show for the new year.
All right. When are you going to let us teach you to do a backflip?
I can't do it. I gotta tell you.
No.
Let me walk you through this.
When?
Let me walk you through this. I don't have a desire to do it. I've never hurt myself in my life, and I've never touched my toes, and I think there's a correlation there. So I just try to stay very, very safe. Now my kids, I understand they are. My wife is happy to pay you guys to teach them, and they could do. I think we got layouts down now. We've got front flips. Backflips. What are we working on now? Are we trying to do something with a twist or some sort of?
Pretty much everybody trying to get to the twisting skills. Yeah.
The twist. So is that the next thing you do after you learn to do a layout there, Rusty?
There's other things you can do before that. There's specialty passes that kind of give the passes more flair, but then everybody wants to get to the fulls eventually.
The fulls?
Which is the twisting.
With the twisting.
What's above the full?
Double.
A double full.
Can anyone do a double full? Are you making that up?
No. I can do it right now.
Can anybody actually do a double full? Can people do a double full?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
can Rusty do a double full?
Rusty can do a double full.
Can you do a double full?
I used to be able to.
Okay, and what's above the double full?
After that, it's really getting into the gymnastics area where it's double flipping, where you're flipping twice, and that's what I broke my neck doing that stuff. So I
did you really break your neck? You did.
Wow.
Did you have a rod put in your neck or whatever?
Yeah, half my neck is metal. Got two rods, couple plates, a lot of screws.
Are you being serious?
Yeah. That's Call impressive. Me Wolverine.
You can't fake that scar. How long did it take you to recover?
I was out my whole junior year, actually. Happened right at the start and was out the entire time. Couldn't do any homework. Only one teacher failed me. That was it.
Thrive Nation, he just blew my mind right there. I'm going to have to duct tape my head back together right there. That right there. Double flips. Avoid Thrive Nation, for safety concerns, with this new year, I want everyone to avoid double flips without supervision from great people like Rusty. We like to end each and every show with a boom. So without any further ado, here we go. 3, 2, 1, boom. All right, Thrive Nation, on today's show, we have a wonderful opportunity to record sort of a testimonial or a success story of a longtime Thriver out there we've worked with by the name of Vidar Lagarde. And just to verify, he's a real person. He's not a hologram. He has a real ministry. The website is safarimission.org, safarimission.org. And we've had a wonderful opportunity to work with him for years and years. And I encourage everybody, check out that website today, safarimission.org. So, Vidar, I've got about 10 questions for you. One is, you know, we've worked together for years. So I thought you could maybe share with the listeners, how long have we worked together approximately? And I'm not looking for I'm not trying to paint you into a corner, but approximately how long have we been working together?
6 years, maybe thereabout, close enough. Rule of thumb numbers here.
Okay, and you now during that time we first met, your focus was and continues to be sharing the gospel with people and equipping people and teaching people how to feed themselves, clothe themselves, how to educate themselves, how to empower themselves. There's a lot of so you have a ministry that focuses on reaching the lost, teaching the gospel, but also on a practical level, empowering people. Could you maybe clarify what is the mission at safarimission.org?
Yeah, so to put it very simply, we train leaders and we transform people. A lot of nonprofits do handouts. We do not do handouts. We help grow people's thinking patterns. Poverty is not lack of money. It's a mindset that produces lack of money. So we deal with the root issue, the mindset. We help people to find Christ because it's hard to get proper ethics if you don't have something correctly in your heart. So we start with the heart issues, and we help people with their mindset and become productive in society. When you climb a ladder, you don't start in the top rung. You start on whatever rung you're at. So wherever they are, we help them get to the next level in life. We're working with such people that they're importing eggs from a different country. Okay, how do you start a chicken farm? How do you start with rabbits? How do you start with food security in that particular case? We're also in Nairobi, huge, huge city. We help established business people get to the next level as well, all through kingdom Christian principles found in the book of Proverbs in the Bible and so forth.
And so when you and I met, one of the big areas that we wanted to focus on was to make giving something that was a recurring thing and not something that we had to go, you know, you wanted to spend 90% of your time reaching the lost and like 10% of your time thinking about the finances, or maybe 5% of your time thinking about the finances and 95% of your time thinking about the lost. And I know we've worked together to be able to increase the amount of recurring giving quite a bit to where it's allowed you to focus on the ministry all the time, every day. Could you maybe share, not looking for numbers, but just for anybody out there that has a ministry or a nonprofit, as far as maybe a percentage, how much you've been able to grow the recurring giving portion of the ministry?
Yes. Over these years, we've grown approximately 800% in recurring giving. And so we were in a situation where a lot of one-time gifts would come in, or the ministry was predominantly operating by one-time gifts. And the issue is you don't know exactly when the next one is coming. It's difficult to budget with that. And so you end up with time periods where things are tight because you're depending on one-time gifts. So you helped us move into recurring giving. And so basically one way of saying that, it's better to have $100 a month than a one-time gift of $1,000 or $2,000 because you can plan on it. And so recurring giving over these years have gone up approximately 800%. We're in a very different situation today where the day-to-day operating costs are, we know what's coming in, and so it's just a whole lot easier to operate.
How has that impacted your ability to reach the lost and empower the lost, having that consistency of revenue? Because again, I deal with business owners all the time, muffler shops, automotive repair shops, dog groomers, dog trainers, veterinarians, photographers, lawyers, churches. And it seems like when the finances are not nailed down, all of the energy has to focus on that. And I know that's never been your heart. Your heart's never been focused on the finances. Your heart's been on reaching the lost. How has that been able to help you at Safari Mission be able to redirect your focus to be just on reaching people?
Well, it's a huge game changer because you're going from maybe 50% of your time and energy thinking about those things. And of course, in a top leadership position, sometimes it's not always just about where your action is at. It's about what's going on in your mind. That's where you're spending some time and energy. So that was about 50% or so. That's down to 10%. So now we're spending 90% on the field, actually helping people, putting together messages, books, content for podcasts. We're in the sweet spot now. We were not in the sweet spot. We were toiling, I guess, is a word that you could use. So it's been a complete game changer.
Now, my final four questions I have for you is, a lot of people, they want to build an organization, but they're not organized. They want to scale, but they've yet to nail it. It's hard to scale it if you haven't nailed it. And I really, right. I mean, if you're listening on today's show, on part two of today's show, I'm going to share a success story about an accountant in Canada. And I really do believe that the accountant in Canada, his business is almost the same as your organization. The reason why he's an accountant is he wants to help people become financially proactive. He's not in ministry. But he really doesn't want to spend his day thinking about the finances. He wants to focus his time on helping people. And I know that's your heart as well. So for anybody out there that hasn't worked with a coach before, and specifically working with me or my team, how did it help you taking a lot of these ideas and to refine it into repeatable systems? How has that impacted your business?
Yeah, it's definitely impacted. And, you know, a big part of coaching is accountability. And so if you want to talk about the 80-20 principle, getting help to focus your time on the stuff that makes the most difference. There is always all these different distractions. There's always all this input that want to pull your mind in different directions. And so having that weekly accountability where you know, okay, let's focus on the top 3 to 5 items every single week. That has really helped to move the needle. And then you can talk about, you know, once in a while you talk about the big picture. So if there's certain things that are disorganized, you work on organizing those things. If you're sales and marketing, for business terminology, I guess, if those areas are not working properly, then you focus on those areas until you get to a place that you successfully operate. It's kind of like getting a wheel to spin, a flywheel. You know, a lot of energy to get that wheel going. And once the wheel is going, you don't need a whole lot of energy. You need some to keep it going, but it's more about managing what's already going. And so helping us transition from, you know, trying to get 50 flywheels going at the same time, you focus on the most important ones. Once you get 2 or 3 going, you can go to 4, 5, and 6. And so I think that's the way it is with business. You got sales and marketing as kind of the offense. Then you got your operations, which is whatever product service you're trying to sell. For us, it's, you know, all the people we're trying to help, we are helping over in East Africa. Then you got the defense. It's the accounting, the legal, those things have to be taken care of. You can't be bleeding on the back end. And so you've helped us put all these things together so that it becomes a holistic picture, and you got all these flywheels and they're up in the air, they are spinning, and you spend a little bit of energy keeping those things going, and then you focus on the sweet spot.
Now, for people out there that you know, utilize our service, we do charge a flat fee. And so I think that's one wonderful thing about your ministry, too, is people reach out to Safari Mission. They go, you know what? I want to do $100 a month. And you're not charging them more than what you agreed to. It's a flat rate. You know, if someone says, I want to donate $5 a month to Safari Mission. And by the way, I recommend people should look into that, safarimission.org. But if someone donates $5 a month or $100 a month or $1,000 a month or whatever it is, you have a high integrity approach to it. You're not nickel and diming your givers. I mean, it's just a very transparent process. We operate the same way where we charge our clients a flat fee. How did that help you knowing that for the past 6 years it was a flat rate as opposed to, you know, most consulting firms I've ever worked with, the fees can go up 10 times more 1 month, 5 times more. Every time you talk to someone, there's an extra charge. How did that help you knowing that you had a flat rate?
Well, flat rates are just a whole lot easier to budget with. You know what's coming in on the income side, and you know what's going out on the outgo or the expense side. So that's been real helpful. And then, of course, you know, the way you operate, it's not just the mentoring or the coaching aspect with your personal time, but it's the whole team that's behind you. So a particular month, we might be, you might be helping us with some project, maybe putting a marketing video together because our own flywheel wasn't spinning the way it should be. So you got your team helping with those things, and it's still been a flat fee. And that's been very, very helpful. So that you don't have to think about project expenses because of your coaching experience.
Now, my final two questions I have for you, final two questions are, if somebody's out there on the fence and they're thinking about, you know, the way it works with our business is we have 160 clients. And so, you know, just yesterday we had a guy whose, his name's Benny, and Benny is a guy who's been wanting to work with us for a long time. We had another lady by the name of Benny. So we had two Bennies in the same period of time, which is interesting. We have a female Benny and a male Benny, and they want to work with us, and we have kind of a waiting list. So we only work with 160 clients, and that's because I don't want to ever stretch myself too thin. I always want to be responsive and be able to be, you know you, know your name, be able to be responsive. So for anybody out there that's thinking about becoming a client or thinking about scheduling that free 13-point assessment at thrivetimeshow.com, what would you say to anybody who's thinking about scheduling that free initial 13-point assessment?
Well, nothing happens by thinking about it. At some point, there has to be action. But my big question would be, are you coachable? Are you willing to make change? A lot of people say they are, but you've got to be hungry enough that you're willing to change your habits. Your daily habits sets you up for success. So make a personal inventory. Make sure you're coachable. Make sure you're willing to change. Make sure you're hungry enough that you're willing to spend, say, maybe 10 hours every single week on working on your business versus working in your business. And then you just aggressively go for it and you call Clay and say, hey, I need to be at the top of that list.
Now, final question I have here again, if just kind of a summary thought, I'm taking notes as you're sharing here. I believe that you said we've helped you to grow by 800%. Maybe there's a different way to quantify it or explain it, but what kind of impact has this coaching over the past 6 years made on safarimission.org, sir?
Well, the ministry has grown tremendously. That 800% is the increase in recurring revenue. We are now building buildings. We're looking at land. We're looking at much larger projects than what we were looking at 8 months, because we're trying to figure out, okay, where's the electricity bill money going to come from? So we're in a very different spot. It means we're helping a whole lot more people. 7 years ago, we were talking about helping thousands of people. Now that we're looking at our annual report and our numbers, we're talking about ministering to 3 million people every single year. That's a huge difference in the amount of people that we talk to every single month. We were talking about 150 churches where the senior leadership was trained up by us. Now we're talking about 500 churches where the senior leadership has been trained by us. So big, big changes in the actual impact of what's happening at safarimission.org.
And again, folks, if you don't know about safarimission.org, I encourage you to check it out. That's safarimission.org. I think a lot of business owners are looking for good causes to donate to, good charities to donate to, people that will be good stewards of those finances. And if you go to safarimission.org and want to request more information, Vidar and his team will be happy to talk to you about how they can partner up with you for as little as $5 a month. Vidar, thank you so much for your time, sir. And I'm sure we'll see you very, very soon.
We will. Thank you, Clay. And you have an awesome day.
Take care.
Hi, my name is Josh Spurl from Spurl & Associates, Chartered Professional Accountants based out of Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. And I met Clay at his conference in Tulsa in June of 2018.
started working with the coaching program shortly after there. You know, the experience has been great. You know, you really have a partner in the grind. You know, most people, I like to say most people are wrong about most things about business most of the time. And it's very difficult for entrepreneurs to connect with other entrepreneurs who actually know what they're talking about when it comes to business. But Clay and his team really does understand. You know, the tangible improvements that we've seen is we're up over 50% since starting with the coaching program. And, they're helping to help business owners create time freedom and financial freedom. And I know what you're going to think. You're going to say, what the heck are you going to do with your time freedom and financial freedom when you're in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada? That's the most northerly city in North America with 1 million people. You know, we're probably just sitting in our igloos hoping for some television. But I'll give you an idea of what we're doing in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. So over here we have Sandra and we have Emma. Emma, say hello.
Hi, everybody. This is my daddy's channel.
Emma really likes any video. So let's see what actually the time freedom, financial freedom can do for you in Edmonton. So believe it or not, we have a beach here, guys. And I'll take you on the little tour of Edmonton's beach. Now it's not what you Americans are gonna think of as a beach. This is a northern beach. Got a really cool slide here. I don't know if you can see this purple slide. This purple slide that you're looking at here is a full loop-de-loop. It knocks you completely upside down when you go to it. See if I can get the right angle here. You know, that does not appear physically possible, but it really is going to knock you upside down. Went on it last time, and here is the Edmonton Beach. This is a northern beach. You guys out in Tulsa. You Americans think you have all the beaches here, but here is the northern beach, complete with waves. We got 30 degree weather inside here. Oh, sorry, 30, that's 90 for you guys over there. I gotta do the translation, the math in my head. And we even got a zip line that we can ride down here. And this is what we're doing with our time freedom and financial freedom in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. Thanks to the Thrivetime team. Thanks very much, guys.
JT, do you know what time it is?
4:10.
It's Tebow time in Tulsa, Jerusalem, baby. Tim Tebow is coming to Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Whoa. During the month of Christmas, December 5th and 6th, 2024, Tim Tebow is coming to Tulsa, Oklahoma in the two-day interactive Thrivetime Show Business Growth Workshop. Yes, folks, put it in your calendar this December, the month of Christmas, December 5th and 6th. Tim Tebow is coming to Tulsa, Oklahoma in the Thrivetime Show two-day interactive business growth workshop.
Whoa. We've been doing business conferences here since 2005. I've been hosting business conferences since 2005. What year were you born?
1995.
Dude, I've been hosting business conferences since you were 10 years old. And a lot of people, you know, have followed Tim Tebow's football career on the field and off the field. And off the field, the guy's been just as successful as he has been on the field. Now, the big question is, JT, how does he do it?
Well, they're going to have to come and find out because I don't know.
Well, I'm just saying, Tim Tebow's going to teach us how he organizes his day, how he organizes his life, how he's proactive with his faith, his family, his finances. He's going to walk us through his mindset that he brings into the gym, into business. It is going to be a blasty blast in Tulsa, Jerusalem.
Folks, I'm telling you, if you want to learn branding, you want to learn marketing, you want to learn search engine optimization, you want to learn social media marketing, that's what we teach at the Thrivetime Show two-day interactive workshop. If you want to learn accounting, you want to learn sales systems, you want to learn how to build a linear workflow, you want to learn how to franchise your business, that is what we teach at the two-day interactive Thrivetime Show business workshop. You know, over the years, we've had the opportunity to feature Michael Levine, the PR consultant of choice for Nike, for Prince, for Michael Jackson. We've had the top PR consultant in the history of the planet has spoken at the Thrivetime Show workshops. We've had Jill Donovan, the founder of RusticCuff.com, a company that creates apparel worn by celebrities all throughout the world. Jill Donovan, the founder of RusticCuff.com, has spoken at the two-day interactive Thrivetime Show business workshops. We have the guy, we've had the man who's responsible for turning around Harley Davidson, a man by the name of Ken Schmidt. He has spoken at the Thrivetime Show two-day interactive business workshops. Folks, I'm telling you, these events are going to teach you what you need to know to start and grow a successful business. And the way we price the events, the way we do these events, is you can pay $250 for a ticket or whatever price that you can afford. What? Yes, we've designed these events to be affordable for you, and we want to see you live and in person at the two-day interactive December 5th and 6th Thrivetime Show business workshop. Everything that you need to succeed will be taught at the two-day interactive Thrivetime Show business workshop December 5th and 6th in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And the way we do these events is we teach for 30 minutes, and then we open it up for a question and answer session so that wonderful people like you can have your questions answered. Yes, we teach for 30 minutes, and then we open it up for a 15-minute question and answer session. It's interactive. It's 2 days. It's in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We've been doing these events since 2005, and I'm telling you, folks, it's going to blow your mind. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, the Thrivetime Show two-day interactive business workshop is America's highest rated and most reviewed business workshop. See the thousands of video testimonials from real people just like you who've been able to build multi-million dollar companies. Watch those testimonials today at ThriveTimeShow.com simply by clicking on the testimonials button right there at ThriveTimeShow.com. You're going to see thousands of people just like you who've been able to go from just surviving to thriving. Whoa. Each and every day, we're going to add more and more speakers to this all-star lineup, but I encourage everybody out there today, get those tickets today. Go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, that's ThriveTimeShow.com. And some people might be saying, well, how do I do it? What do I do? How does it work? You just go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Let's go there now. We're feeling the flow. We're going to ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, you just go to ThriveTimeShow.com. You click on the Business Conferences button, and you click on the Request Tickets button right there. The way I do our conferences is we tell people it's $250 to get a ticket.
Yep.
Or whatever price that you could afford. And the reason why I do that is I grew up without money. JT, you're in the process of building a super successful company. Yep. Did you start out with $1 million in the bank account?
No, I did not. Nope. Did not get any loans, nothing like that. Did not get an inheritance from parents or anything like that. I had to work for it. And I'm super grateful I came to a business conference. That's actually how I met you, met Peter Taunton. I met all these people.
So if you're out there today and you want to come to our workshop, again, you just got to go to ThriveTimeShow.com. You might say, well, who's speaking? We already covered that. You might say, where's it going to be? It's going to be in Tulsa, Rusalem, Oklahoma. And someone says, Tulsa, Rusalem. I'm really trying to rebrand Tulsa as Tulsa, Rusalem, sort of like the Jerusalem of America. But if you go to, if you type in Thrivetime Show and Jinx, you can get a sneak peek or a look at our office facility. This is what it looks like. This is where you're headed. It's going to be a blasty blast. You can look inside, see the facility. We're going to have hundreds of entrepreneurs here. It is going to be packed. Now, for this particular event, folks, the seating is always limited because my facility isn't a limitless convention center. You're coming to my actual home office, and so it's going to be packed. Who? You. You're going to come. Who? You. I'm talking to you. You can just get your tickets right now at ThriveTimeShow.com, and again, you can name your price. We tell people it's $250 or whatever price you can afford, and we do have some select VIP tickets, which gives you an access to meet some of the speakers and those sorts of things, and those tickets are $500. It's a two-day interactive business workshop, over 20 hours of business training. We're going to give you a copy of my newest book, The Millionaire's Guide to Becoming Sustainably Rich. You're going to leave with a workbook. You're going to leave with everything you need to know to start and grow a super successful company. It's practical, it's actionable, and it's Tebow time right here in Tulsa, Jerusalem. Get those tickets today at ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, that's ThriveTimeShow.com.
Hello, I'm Michael Levine, and I'm talking to you right now from the center of Hollywood, California, where I have represented over the last 35 years 58 Academy Award winners, 34 Grammy Award winners, 43 New York Times bestsellers. I've represented a lot of major stars, and I've worked with a lot of major companies. And I think I've learned a few things about what makes them work and what makes them not work. Now, why would a man living in Hollywood, California, in the beautiful sunny weather of LA, come to Tulsa? Because last year I did it, and it was damn exciting. Clay Clark has put together an exceptional presentation. Really life-changing. And I'm looking forward to seeing you then. I'm Michael Levine. I'll see you in Tulsa.
Thrivetime Show two-day interactive business workshops are the world's highest rated and most reviewed business workshops because we teach you what you need to know to grow.
You can learn the proven 13-point business systems that Dr. Zellner and I have used over and over to start and grow successful companies. I mean, we get into the specific steps on what you need to do to optimize your website. We're going to teach you how to fix your conversion rate. We're going to teach you how to do a social media marketing campaign that works. How do you raise capital? How do you get a small business loan? We teach you everything you need to know here during a two-day, 15-hour workshop. It's all here for you. You work every day in your business, but for 2 days you can escape and work on your business and build these proven systems so now you can have a successful company that will produce both the time freedom and the financial freedom that you deserve. You're going to leave energized, motivated, but you're also going to leave empowered. The reason why I've built these workshops is because as an entrepreneur, I always wish that I had this. And because there wasn't anything like this, I would go to these motivational seminars, no money down, real estate, Ponzi scheme, get motivated seminars, and they would never teach me anything. It was like you went there and you paid for the big chocolate Easter bunny, but inside of it, it was a hollow nothingness. And I wanted the knowledge, and they're like, oh, but we'll teach you the knowledge after our next workshop. And the great thing is we have nothing to upsell. At every workshop, we teach you what you need to know. There's no one in the back of the room trying to sell you some next big get-rich-quick, walk-on-hot-coals product. It's literally, we teach you the brass tacks, the specific stuff that you need to know to learn how to start and grow a business. And I encourage you to not believe what I'm saying, and I want you to Google the Z66 auto auction. I want you to Google elephant in the room. Look at Robert Zellner and Associates. Look them up and say, are they successful because they're geniuses, or are they successful because they have a proven system? When you do that research, you will discover that the same systems that we use in our own business can be used in your business. Come to Tulsa, book a ticket, and I guarantee you it's going to be the best business workshop ever, and we'll even give you your money back if you don't love it. We've built this facility for you, and we're excited to see you.
And now you may be thinking, what does it actually cost to attend an in-person two-day interactive Thrivetime Show business workshop? Well, good news. The tickets are $250 or whatever price that you can afford. What? Yes, they're $250 or whatever price you can afford. I grew up without money, and I know what it's like to live without money. So if you're out there today and you want to attend our in-person two-day interactive business workshop, all you got to do is go to thrivetimeshow.com to request those tickets. And if you can't afford $250, we have scholarship pricing available to make it affordable for you.
I learned at the Academy, Kings Point in New York, acta non verba. Watch what a person does, not what they say.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Robert Kiyosaki, the Rich Dad Radio Show. Today I'm broadcasting from Phoenix, Arizona, not Scottsdale, Arizona. They're close, but they're completely different worlds. And we have a special guest today. Definition of intelligence is, if you agree with me, you're intelligent. And so this gentleman is very intelligent. I've done his show before also, but very seldom do you find somebody who lines up on all counts. And it's a Mr. Clay Clark. He's a friend of a good friend, Eric Trump. But we're also talking about money, bricks, and how screwed up the world can get in a few and a half hour. So Clay Clark is a very intelligent man. And there's so many ways we could take this thing. But I thought, since you and Eric are close, Trump, what were you saying about what Trump can't, what Donald, who's my age, and I can say or cannot say?
I have to honor you, sir. I want to show you what I did to one of your books here. There's guy by the name of Jeremy Thorne, who was my boss at the time. I was 19 years old, working at Faith Highway. I had a job at Applebee's, Target, and DirecTV. And he said, have you read this book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad? And I said, no. And my father, may he rest in peace, he didn't know these financial principles. So I started reading all of your books and really devouring your books. And I went from being an employee to self-employed to the business owner to the investor. And I owe a lot of that to you. And I just wanted to take a moment to tell you thank you so much for allowing me to achieve success. And then I'll tell you all about Eric Trump. But I just want to tell you thank you, sir, for changing my life.
But not only that, Clay, you know, thank you, but you've become an influencer. You know, more than anything else, you've evolved into an influencer where your word has more and more power. So that's why I congratulate you on becoming. Because as you know, there's a lot of fake influencers out there too, or bad influencers.
Yeah.
So anyway, I'm glad you and I agree so much. And thanks for reading my books.
Yeah.
That's the greatest thrill for me today. Not a thrill, but recognition is when people, young men especially, come up and say, I read your book, changed my life. I'm doing this, I'm doing this, I'm doing this.
I learned at the Academy, Kings Point in New York, acta non verba. Watch what a person does, not what they say. Whoa.